It's now my immense pleasure to introduce our next guest, Joseph Grigely, with whom we've had conversations over many, many years about the topic, actually, of traces. So it's wonderful that Joseph is here. The idea of traces, of fragmentation, many of the topics which were addressed earlier, play such a pivotal role in his work and in the way how he actually connects fragments and traces of conversation and makes new conversations out of them. And of course, for all of us who see conversations, allows us to make new conversations out of it. The work of Joseph is fundamentally about conversations. You can say it is a very, very complex conversation piece. His work are based on daily life experiences and scraps on paper on which people actually communicate with him. He represents here a lecture, I think, so it will not be an interview, it will be a lecture, but we can then address him with questions. He lives and works in Chicago, where he's professor of visual and critical studies at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. He's also very involved with works there with his students on different notions of archives, collecting exhibitions on archives. And he's also pioneered a whole, one could say, discipline of exhibition making, which I find very fascinating, which is the perspective of exhibitions, which is a topic of one of his many books. And in a similar way as earlier today with A.R. Weitzman, I have to urge you all to read Joseph's book. His notions of, you know, text authority and so on are among the most amazing kind of reading we could do parallel reading to today's conference. So a very, very warm welcome to Joseph Grigely.
Everyone, can you hear me okay back there? I'm very happy to join you today. And I'd like to thank the organizers and sponsors for the effort to realize this truly wonderful occasion. I talked this afternoon, it's about conversations, ordinary, everyday conversations. How do we represent conversations as a visual construction? In the history of art, there are many examples, like this piece of new cinema. What's interesting here is the way we can see people engage in the conversational change. There's so much detail. The problem is the lack of another kind of detail. We don't know what they are saying. That's a problem with the traditional conversation beats of Western Europe. Hogarth, Gainsborough, Canaletto. They work often portrays people clumped together and talking, yet they say and reveal absolutely nothing about what they are talking about. Imagine if we were able to gather together the words that someone spoke in a day, or a week, or even a lifetime. Just the words, or as Robert Musil wrote in his diaries, construct a person from nothing but quotations. Today I intend to construct some people from their conversations. The conversations are not spoken conversations, they are written conversations. Words, marks, drawings, all written by the speaker. It's possible because I am totally deaf. I became deaf for 1 year when I was 1 year old from a fever. I still had a little bit of hearing left in the other year until I was 10 years old when I was playing with some friends and I fell down the hill. And it was like somebody had turned off the sound to the world. How do you communicate with hearing people when you are deaf? This is a painting by Joshua Reynolds, his self-portrait of the Aristotle deaf man. The dilemmas and making conversations with hearing people at E.A.T when you are totally deaf. When people speak to me, I usually ask them to write down for me what they are saying. It's simple, it's practical, it works pretty well. Instead of looking at people in the eyes when they talk, I spend a lot of time looking at their hands. I don't think there's much difference, really, whether I focus on the face or the hands. A portrait is not just a visual construction, but a verbal one as well. We remember people not just for what they look like, but for what they think and say. So maybe Robert Mutzel had it right. People are constructions of their words. Yet for every word we hear and speak, there are words misspoken and words misheard. So that in the end, every portrait is both the portrayal and the betrayal. Let me tell you a story. One day, many years ago, I found myself on Madison Avenue in New York City. It was a cold and slightly snowy afternoon in December at the beginning of the holiday season. As I walked downtown, I passed by the Cherry Lemon Wine Store. Cherry Lemon's not like most wine stores. There's only one bottle of each wine on display. When you find something that you want, the clerk will take your order, then go down to the cellar and fetch it. After a while, I found a couple of bottles of Bordeaux that I wanted to buy, and the polite clerk took my order, disappeared, reappeared, and then a strange thing happened. She took, so it seemed, at least 10 minutes to wrap up the four bottles I had ordered. Part of the reason it took her so long was because she got involved in a very engaging exchange with one of the other clerks. They stood together at the counter, the two of them. She slowly wrapping up the bottles of wine, he slowly adding up the numbers of an account. While she wrapped and while he added, they were talking, smiling, laughing, and really enjoying themselves. I was perplexed, of course, and tried as well as I could try to imagine what they were talking about. The wine? The holidays? It had to be something about the holidays. It was written all over their faces. When the clerk finally handed me my package, I thanked her politely. And pardon me myself, I explained to both clerks that I was deaf, and a little curious as to what they had been discussing. It seemed, so I said, such a pleasurable conversation. Would they mind telling me what it was all about? I don't suppose they had to believe me, or even tell me what they were talking about, but they did. If people like to talk, one thing I've learned over the years is that they also like to write. To write, that's a form of talking. As if our conversation is private, as if it cannot be overheard, with the voice of the speaker is bound up in the handwriting of the speaker. Here are a few examples. Occasionally, after a conversation, someone will remove the words by turning the words into charms, and the charms become traces of an otherwise evanescent exchange. Here's another one. And sometimes in the blur of the moment, the words themselves are so gallant. The first time I showed the conversation paper to Eric was in 1994. They consisted of one or more conversation papers with the Black Queen starting line. This is one of the conversations, and I'm going to now read you the starting line. One night when I was in New York, I was heading back to my car in Soho when a man gestured to me. He rubbed his stomach with his hand and seemed to say, "Fool, fool." But I wasn't too sure if this is what he really said. So I asked him to write. I took some paper out of my pocket and gave him a pencil. I knew it seemed a little strange, but I really wanted to know what he was saying. The man seemed a little surprised by my request, but he took it seriously and started to write. The letters came slowly, M, O, N, and then he stopped. He seemed confused, as if he wasn't sure what came next. But the line paused, then he crossed out the unfinished word and tried to start again. He wrote the letter M, but stopped and didn't continue. He paused again, and then he crossed out the M. Then he moved over to a railing, leaned on it, and tried a third time. He wrote another M. By now I sense anxiety on his part. He stole paying glances at passers-by, perhaps hoping that someone would help him in his effort to communicate. He looked back down at the M he had made and tried to erase it, but my pencil did not erase it, so he did with this M what he did with the previous M. He crossed it out. At this point, he could have given up. People were walking by, tangled with spinning knots, and the spirit that begins with an M would not write itself. He tried again. But this time he tried a new direction, one that shifted from object to subject. He wrote down the letter I, then there was a pause, then he wrote down M-Y, and then another pause, and finally crossed it all out. This was the end, and in a sense, it said more than enough. More perhaps than mere words could have said. Sometimes the effort to write said much more than the message itself. You know how it is that people try to say very profound things. We are all guilty of this desire for the epic utterance. At the other extreme, it's the ordinary, unexceptional small talk, conversations that have no great import, except for the fact they are part of the way the world lives every day. This comment about cat litter is a good example. A friend told me this one day when she was late meeting me. I had to set up cat litter, and she wrote, "How profound is that?" At your works, the conversations took on different shapes over the years. For the Berlin Biennial in 2001, we reprinted four of the conversations, and then just dropped them all over Berlin. In cafes, on the ground, on trains, like words that just fell from a conversation and drifted into the world. Eventually, the papers were grouped together as verbal and visual narratives, something like this. And sometimes they ended up as sculptures, at a table constructed as a still life, showing off the detritus of a conversational change, the words, the beer cans, the empty peanut shells. Eventually, I need not to assemble it. I can install etching called White Lord, which has already protected at the Museum of Modern Art in the City of Paris. White Lord is an oval room, approximately 10 meters long and 6 meters wide and 4 meters high, built floor to ceiling with computations on white paper. The thing about this piece that it's important is the sheer volume of computations that fill the room. The piece has about 3,000 papers, but spoken computations, evanescent, it disappears. But the written computations pile up. It's amazing how vast the archive of ordinary speech might be if we could record it all. When George tries to do that, there's another version, which I call Black Noise, which I haven't shown yet, which consists of conversations that are all on colored paper. Let me say, as a brief conclusion of sorts, these are the people I talk with. They're all pictured here. There's Susan, there's Sam, there's Paula, there's Ethan Father, Finborough Mahoney, my Latin teacher in college. They're real people. But by the time the words are combined with other words, they become fictions. They become characters of a visual novel that has no beginning and no end. A novel that is all middle. A novel of incomplete sentences, of unfinished stories, of scratched out thoughts, bits and pieces of everyday life. Like Robert Musil said, people who are made out of their words. Thank you. If you have any questions now, I'd be happy to answer them.
Thank you so much. It's now the moment for questions for our Joseph Grigely. Maybe you can change the light situation. That would be great. Thank you. But maybe sit down, that's better, no?
Sure.
It's more comfortable for you. And if you can switch off this front here, it'll be great.
Lisa?
Okay, great.
Okay, questions for Joseph Grigely? Yeah, we've got a question here in the meeting.
Actually, I'm not sure if this is all right, but I have a question for you, Hans. I'm curious how Joseph's practice has actually informed or perhaps inspired or influenced your research into handwriting and especially your Instagram project with handwritten notes. Maybe you could talk about if your work relates or how that started.
Yeah, I'm very glad you're asking this because I was actually about to say that and tell a story because either way, it was of course extremely, extremely inspiring. We installed this extraordinary white chapel in the Musée d'Amadin, which Joseph showed us, and had long conversations with him about the necessity of, you know, maintaining handwriting. And then, in a way, I would say the urgency of it became further enhanced when Umberto Eco wrote an essay where he said, you know, that we can observe now in the digital age, in the last couple of years, that teenagers no longer use handwriting, and there's the danger of extinction of handwriting. And then, at that moment, when we sat in a cafe, wrote a poem on a paper napkin, and you know, I just posted it on Instagram. So it was a kind of a chain reaction of some sorts, but nothing would have happened without Joseph Grigely. As I always say, E-S-W-J-G, everything starts with Joseph Grigely.
I'm going to add a little bit to that. I remember your interview with Hans-Jörg Gadamer, and Gadamer remarked that for him, writing couldn't convey the range of inflection, emotion that the human voice could convey. in many contemporary linguists believe that so much in our community is bound up in our voices, our identity, the nuance in it. But for me, I can't try to switch with identity. Well, so far, I don't know anyone who's looked at the same square of inflection, incarnation, or all the way through handwriting. And that's bound up in the individual, except for handwriting, so individual now, like a vortex.
And also, Galamao, it was actually interesting because he was 100 years old when we did this conversation, which you read. I was in his house alone with him, and he fell asleep. And it was really weird, you know, here I was with this 100-year-old philosopher. I didn't know what to do, I was really anxious, and I couldn't possibly wake him up. But then luckily the telephone rang, and about 10 minutes in, it was a very long 10 minutes, they felt like an eternity. And he asked the guy, he was perfectly aware of what had happened. He said, yeah, internet, he hung up the telephone. And he looked at me and he said, you will have a very hard time to transcribe my silence. Now, Joseph, one thing before we, I hope there are going to be more questions for Joseph. I have one question I want to ask you about, you know, traces and fragments. It's a question I already asked A.R. also, because we have this wonderful text from Joshua Griffith, which he's going to present tomorrow alongside some of his works. There will be a small exhibition here of Joshua Griffith. And Joshua wrote about the distinction, really, between, you know, traces and fragments. And in a way, says that, you know, fragments are part of something larger that may be lost or living in another dimension, and that every fragment is a trace, but not every trace is a fragment. And he says that in his opinion, we can tell that the works of Shakespeare, Rembrandt, Mozart are traces of general human history. But it's kind of difficult, so they are traces of human history, but it's difficult to tell if they are fragments too. So it could be said that they are borderless, endless fragments, but that would mean they are fragments no more. So I kind of was curious to hear your comments on that.
Oh, that's a big subject. Look at the example of Sir John Soane's museum, and I one of our favorite museums. So much a bit of an arcane British architect who collected architectural ruins and fragments of buildings from ancient Greece and Rome, and filled his house with these fragments. In the museum, the fragment becomes a whole, very important consideration, with the conversation papers. While they are both the traits of a conversation and a fragment, when they become fictions, they become a whole. They're no longer in a certain sense of physical traits of that conversation, even though they are. It's like a simultaneous ontology for them. Because they become to the viewer a pure fiction. They don't know who wrote the conversation. And I'm not about to say. I think that's very, very important that we are looking at some sense of human identity and human history in the conversation. But the significance of the individual speaker, who exactly the person is, doesn't really matter. If I made it matter, then I'd have to be very careful about names that appear in someone. That's why I'm trying not to reveal any individual names.
I think we have time for one or two more questions. Questions for Joseph Friedman.
Please, a question. Who can write it if you want? So nobody can hear you ask it.
Well, I felt like you have a last question. I was kind of thinking, you know, there is an element of performance within this sharing of notes, no? I always remember when we were in restaurants, you know, once we did it even in public, you know, occupied in Venice, when we sort of did a sort of performance passing these notes, the passing from one body to the other, the, you know, the facial expressions, all of that seems to be a performance. But I'm kind of interested how you understand this performativity within the act of note sharing. It's obviously particularly interesting, you know, when we consider that our unconscious cognitive performance of body language is often limited when engaged in this process of, you know, of writing and sharing.
It's a great subject, really, because often when I'm having conversations with people and they're writing, they will pause to consider what they're saying. And when we're talking with people, we don't give wrong parts. The social obligation of the situation forces us to keep moving forward. No parts. And then finally, before they give me the paper, they would sometimes hand it in a way, and I look at each other in the eye and take the paper. Very different kinds of conversational protocol come out of the process of writing back and forth. And these aspects of facial expressions or linguistics called super segmentals are the things that make this kind of conversational change so important, because it shows us how different conversation is than language itself. For conversation involves embodied language. And that body is so important to the whole process. So talk to our hands.
That could not be a better conclusion. But now we have more questions. So we've got a question for Dani, and then a question.
I said we only have 3 minutes, but now I have a question.
Yeah, I said that we only have 3 minutes, but now I have a question. So my question is, how did internet, email, how did that affect your practice, or maybe not at all, or what would you have to say about this?
I actually started using email back in the days of Vietnam. We're talking about 1983. I thought it was a godsend for a deaf person. That time I started teaching deaf students, and this is what we did. In the classroom, we hooked up a dozen computers, so everybody was online at the same time, so we could teach English through English. We were writing back and forth to each other, so we weren't using sign language, we might teach English with English. Now the fascinating thing about this, we even developed a system where you could ping a particular person. We never thought of patenting that. This is 1983. This is before the internet became any kind of reality. Now, the interesting social effect that happened like that with the development of texting and email and so on, they used to have a kind of world. The students would always get together and talk because sign language is what we call an oral language. You look at face to face. You can't use a video now. But back then, face to face, the students started standing in rooms and emailing each other. And that process really changed face to face communication. It's really changed my work at all. I started developing new projects that move beyond the conversations. I've been working with the conversations for 20 years and something I don't see myself stopping. But like I said, people love to write. It's something, and you know people love to write too. You see that happening with the Instagram project. It's something intimate, personal, private, that we feel a bond to. It's a tactile experience. We live in a culture that really lacks tactile meaning, so it's that thing that happened.
Thank you so much. Thank you.